This is my 2020 year-end review for our solar panels, Tesla Powerwall 2, and myenergi eddi zappi performance here in the UK. I'll also cover the year's running costs and usage for our Tesla Model 3 performance and our Hyundai Kona electric cars. So, stay tuned. Hi, John here, and welcome. I'm going to take you through our solar PV and Tesla Powerwall 2 performance for 2020. A year-end review covering stats, usage information, performance, costs, and so on. I'll also show you our Feed In Tariff payments as well. In the description down below is a list of all our components for our system. So please have a look down there if you're not familiar with our setup and our system. Let's jump straight into it and we'll look at our annual PV generation and income. For the year, we have generated 7,071 kilowatt hours from our combined 6.32 kilowatt solar arrays. That's 7.07 megawatts of electricity generated, which is incredible to think about it like that. I worked it out as an average of 19.3 kilowatt hours of solar generation every day over the course of the year. Actually, that would be fabulous to get guaranteed daily output like that, come rain or shine, but as you all know, it doesn't quite work like that. Looking at the graph, you'll see there's a large spike on the graph in 2020. This is due to the second 2.34 kilowatt array coming online. It was installed on the 30th of October 2019, which meant it had 2 months of generation added to the total of 2019 and the whole 12 months of generation included in the 2020 total. The new array is 58% of the size of the 4 kilowatt original solar array. So let me cover our feed-in tariff or FiT payments for the year. We are paid quarterly, and in 2020 we've been paid a very healthy £2,545 for the year. This is our highest annual payment to date. This FiT payment is only paid against our total generation of the original 4 kilowatt array. The new array has no FiT payment attached to it. So this gives us an accumulative total for our FiT payments from 2011 onwards to date of £20,098.44. That's around €22,645 at today's exchange rate, or $27,480 to give you some context if you're watching in another country. The FiT scheme payments for us run for 25 years, and we've been using the profit from the FiT payments to finance additional solar and the Tesla Powerwall 2 installations. And I'm due to do a separate video on that, which will cover all of our costs and installation of all of our components and where we are with that, because one or two people have asked for that. So watch that coming soon. I've also done some forecasting. If we forecast our total income from our FiT payments over the 25 years, it'll actually yield around £55,829 based on our average payment, yearly payment to date of £2,233. And as I mentioned earlier, to date, all the funds we have received have been ploughed back into getting more solar and the Tesla Powerwall. This particular chart looks at the quarterly FiT payments over the years. You can see in 2020 a massive spike in quarter two payments, which is the red dotted line on this graph. Quarter two covered March, April and May 2020, during which time we experienced some really long spells and hot sunny weather here in the UK, hence the higher payment for the additional solar generation during that quarter. The spike in 2012 for the blue line, which is quarter one payments, is due to including our first ever FiT payment for September to December 2011 onto the quarter one 2012 payment. So in effect, there's two quarters represented by that one data point, which is why it's so spiky. Let's have a look at the Powerwall and solar yearly chart and see how they've performed over the year. So this chart shows key in and out data metrics for the last 2 years, 2019 and 2020. It covers overall home usage, solar generation, energy taken from the Powerwall, energy sent to the Powerwall. This will be excess solar and grid power at cheap off-peak rates. Energy pulled from the grid and then surplus solar energy sent to the grid. Our home usage has gone up in 2020 to 12,158 kilowatt hours of electricity used, which is a 32% increase over 2019 total. This will be due to a number of reasons, really. We've both retired and being at home the majority of the time means we're going to use more energy as a result. Multiple lockdowns throughout the year, so less days out. We've also got two EVs to charge and have more regular, been using our glass kilns on a more regular basis in the studio. Well, solar generation has also increased, and a number of factors have influenced that. A couple of heat waves throughout the year with a phenomenal solar activity, and a full year with additional the solar array, which I mentioned earlier. So solar production has increased by 72% over the 2019 totals, which actually goes some way to offset the extra home usage. I will show you that offset data in the next graph. The to and from the Powerwall figures are both slightly higher than 2020. Round-trip efficiency of putting that power in and getting it back out again was 87% in 2020 versus 90% in 2019. So we'll see how that maps out at the end of 2021, see if that's a continual decline or it's just a one-off. It may be just the cut-off between the two point data points at year-end. We'll see. So we pulled slightly more from the grid in 2020 over 2019, an additional 361 kilowatt hours, which actually is next to nothing over the course of the year, 6% in fact, or 1 kilowatt hour per day, which I guess is even more impressive when you recall that we've used 32% more electricity during the year. And that proves that the vast majority of that did not come from the grid. In terms of what we send to the grid, we've actually doubled what we sent back, 1,039 kilowatt hours against 508 kilowatt hours in 2019. Generating more solar typically results in more surplus going back to the grid, we've found. Moving on, this chart shows our solar energy offset as well as our overall self-power performance. The first column shows in percentage terms how much our solar generation contributed to our overall house usage or home usage. In 2019, shown in blue, solar covered just 47% of our home's usage, whereas in 2020, the red column, it's covered 61% of our total house needs. I have actually noticed a slight deviation in figures between what the Tesla Powerwall states our solar generation total is and what our two solar generation meters state. The meters will be more accurate, certainly, and the difference is only like 4% in favour of the Tesla, i.e. it shows 4% more generation than we actually generated. So just a heads up there on that, just in case you're looking cross-referencing figures. The next data set looks at what percentage did our solar system contribute to our overall self-power figure. Our overall self-power figure is derived from adding the self-power percentage for the solar and the power all together. In 2019, that would have been 25% plus 26% equals 51% self-powered. In 2020, that total was 62%, 34% solar, 28% battery. Again, the higher solar self-power figure for 2020 was get down to the extra solar array on the roof. Moving along to look at how we did during the peak period. This occurs every day between 4 p.m. and 8 p.m. Well, Actually, it's only till 7 p.m. However, I've extended the time band within the Tesla Powerwall app to 8 p.m. as sometimes the unit rates of electricity can still be quite high up to 8 p.m. So using this later timestamp ensures that we don't dip into those higher prices and pull from the grid. During peak time, we have been 99% self-powered for the 2 years of running. Testament to the efficiency of the Powerwall and how it actually manages that. The off-peak time slot is the remaining 20 hours of the day outside those 4 hours of peak. And here we managed to be just 6% self-powered. And I guess 6% figure is not surprising, as in the winter months we'll be charging the cars, running the glass kilns, charging up the battery, the Powerwall battery, mostly from the grid during that off-peak time period. Often in the early hours of the morning when the electricity is at its cheapest for us. We're on the Octopus Energy on their Agile tariff. So I've done a separate video on the Agile tariff. If you're interested in learning a bit more about that, shan't go into it here. Let's have a look at the eddi. So the eddi diverts excess solar energy that the house cannot use to heat our hot water by means of the immersion heater. For the year, it's heated our hot water with 395 kilowatt hours of free solar energy. And it's got a running total since installation back in July 2019 of 467 kilowatt hours. I've calculated a saving of £21.14 for the year in electricity costs. So not big savings by any stretch of the imagination. However, you know, every little bit helps. Next one to look at is the Zappi. This chart covers both cars, the Tesla Model 3 Performance and the Hyundai Kona SE Premium 64 kilowatt model. That really rolls off the tongue, that one. Neither car has covered many miles during the year due to lockdowns, which appeared to be every other week. So the Tesla has covered 6,462 miles in the year and has cost £72.96 in electricity for charging. The Kona has covered 2,167 miles in the year and has cost £52.67 in electricity for charging. According to the Zappi, we've used 3,780 kilowatt hours of charging and for the year, 63% of that from the grid and 37% from solar. So that is 2,363 kilowatt hours and 1,416 kilowatt hours respectively. Other costs for the year for the cars. The Tesla's had no costs apart from charging or anything that I've already mentioned. So no servicing, no maintenance, no repairs, nothing. The Kona had no maintenance. It did have a service and a repair to a puncture in the tyre, which I guess in fairness, you know, a puncture could have happened to either car, so not holding it against the car, it's your fault car. It is, however, a cost attributed to the car, and it came in £119 for a new tyre fitted and balanced. The first annual service cost £68.04. Also, on the 30th of December, the Kona's developed a fault where the front passenger seatbelt warning alarm sounds regardless to whether there's a passenger in the front seat or not. And this is most annoying. And it can only be silenced by putting the seatbelt for the passenger seat in the buckle or waiting 30 seconds until the beeping stops. But then later on, it remembers and goes, "Oh my God, you've got no seatbelt on," and it starts off again. So it's a bit dull. I suspect it's a seat sensor that's sort of gone west. I'll update you once I know more about that little problem and what the cost will be. Putting all the costs together, the Tesla's cost £72.96 for the year, which, as I said earlier, is purely for charging. And that's home charging. Public charging was free. And the Kona's cost £239.71 for the year, which covers charging, servicing, repairs and maintenance and whatever the seat belt sensory thing is as well. So there you go. Please comment, like, share, all of those good actions really help to get this video shown to more people on YouTube, which in turn helps my channel grow. Thank you for watching, and I will see you on the next video. All right, take care. Bye.